Good morning, everyone. Please stand and worship with me this morning. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Alleluia, praise the one who set me free. Alleluia, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are my living hope. Please take a seat.
Thanks so much, Scott.
We were
earlier this morning in the office on our computers and listening to Scott practice. It was like having our own concert. It was great. So we appreciate him leading us in worship today. And several announcements this morning. There's a number of folks that we've been meeting with to interview to hear their testimonies for membership, and so in the next several weeks we'll be presenting some of them as candidates for membership. And the first is Steve and Kathy Paxay. I don't think they're here this morning. They're still back and forth between Wolfboro and here at times, but the elders are recommending them for membership at LBC. If you have any questions or comments on their membership, please see Fred or I, and we'll look forward to welcoming them as members next Sunday. And we'll be doing this for several people. Thank you also for those who we launched the Northeast Kingdom Children's Club this Friday. And so that went smoothly. Yeah, there we go. I think we had 17 kids come. And so it was a great launch, a great start. I want to make you aware of that. It's each Friday from 5:30 to 7:30. And if you need information or you'd like to volunteer to help, see those two in the back, the woo-woo girl and her husband. And then also a reminder, next Sunday is a fellowship meal for us. We invite you and encourage you to stay and join the fellowship around the table. And you're just asked to bring a salad and dessert and to share, and the rest will be provided. And then also this week, this Saturday is a memorial service for Carolyn Gadapi at 10 a.m. There'll be a light luncheon to follow. We're still in need of some cookies for that luncheon, so if you can email Sue. Sue's sick, but she's still doing work from home even though she's sick. So you can email her to let her know how many cookies you can bring. And there will also be visiting hours on Friday evening from 5 to 7 at Gibbard Funeral Home in Lindenville. So we want to make you aware of that and encourage you to come and support this family. I think we could also pray for Sherry this morning. She's not feeling well either, so keep her in prayer. She's had a rough go health-wise here lately. We wanted you to know that Carolyn Gadapi, some of you don't know her. She could rarely attend church. She was bedridden for many years. But in spite of that, she had a huge heart for children. And she became an ardent participant in making items, chiefly through knitting, for our Operation Christmas Child. So this year we want to dedicate our Operation Christmas Child in her memory to Carolyn Gadapi. And we have on the back table, I believe there's some her picture and some items that she made for Operation Christmas Child to help you get to know her a little bit. We want to show a video that we did a couple of years ago that highlights her passion for Operation Christmas Child. So we'll show that video.
Hey, LBC, it's that time again when we're packing shoeboxes. And I want you today to come in with me and meet Carolyn, who has done an inspirational thing. When she heard about the boxes, she has created 500 little somethings for each box. And I think that you will be amazed by her inspiration and her hope, and also being somebody who's bedridden and able to do something for somebody else. So please join me. Come in and meet Carolyn.
Welcome to our home. Thank you so much. I understand you've knitted quite a few things for our boxes.
Yes, we counted. My daughter Sherry and I counted about 2 weeks ago, and we have between 500 and 600 little purses for little girls or little satchels for little boys. At some point we'll have an exact count, but we're closer to 600 than we are 500. I met my husband in the fall of 1957. We met in Danville at a hayride. I saw this handsome fellow standing there alone, And I probably didn't pay quite as much attention to the hayride as I might have. Couldn't get my eyes off him. We just had a wonderful, wonderful relationship. And I always had a passion for little children. From the time I was 8 years old, I started knitting when I was taking care of my husband. He had Alzheimer's, and we kept him here in our home for 9 years. I knitted dishcloths. It was kind of a no-brainer thing. I could pick it up, put it down, and I could keep him company in here and try to make him happy. And then I got very ill with the shingles virus, and it left me with 3 fingers on my left hand, totally numb. There was no feeling, and excruciating pain down my arm, and I had to put my knitting away. So I didn't knit for a few years. And then one day, I sat here thinking, I just wish I could knit. And Sherry got my knitting needles for me and brought me some yarn into my room. And lo and behold, I was able to knit again. So I started making dishcloths, and I got up to between 200 and 300 of them. I continued to make those, and Sherry asked if she could have some to use for washcloths for children in the shoeboxes. So I kept the knitting needles going, and I made boodles of dishcloths. About Christmas time, Sherry said to me, "Do you think, Mom, that you could take some of the dishcloths and make them into little purses for little children?" And I thought, I bet I can do something. Yes. So I started. This, I call this the body of the little satchel. Okay. So it's knitted, and I can put it together like this, or I can put it together like this, and it's totally different. But I have some right here, has the little purse with a washcloth in it. Cool. Yes, I do them for girls and boys. My goal was to have 100 made. Well, I did that in a very short time because it was just so much fun. And I was just so blessed. I had yarn brought to me, and it's just, it's been so heartwarming for me to be able to do this and to know that I could still do something for little children. I get up several times in the night, and sometimes I'll sit for 15 or 20 minutes, watch the clock, and I knit for a while, and I'm like, no, I've got to put it down. I need to get my legs up on the bed. But it's just been such a gift to me that the Lord healed me enough so I could knit again. Yes. Because so I led a very active life for many, many years. And I was happiest when I was doing something prayerfully that made someone else's day more pleasant. And that has been my goal forever, for as long as I can remember. And to think that the Lord brought this to me and made me realize that I'm not done yet. I need to keep making, and I have learned that I can knit lying down. Not as fast, but I don't have to hurry. It's just such a gift all the way around that I can do this.
Well, we thank Joel for doing that video. And next time you're feeling sorry for yourself like me, so stand up so they can see who you are. This is Steve. All right, we'll continue.
Please stand and we'll continue to worship. Earth has quaked before, the sound of his voice. Seas that are shaken and stirred can be calmed and broken from my regard. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe, even when my eyes can't see. And this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are on you. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are on you, and it is well, it is well. So let go my soul and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. So let go my soul and trust in him. The waves and wind still know his name. The waves and wind still know his name. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. Well with me. I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Our sin runs deep. Your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, when I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Great worship. You may have a seat.
Good morning. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Lord, we come to you, Lord, as we sang this morning, our living hope in a world that desperately needs hope, Lord. Pray, Lord, for the war going on in Israel, Lord, that you'll be with the people of Israel and just that you'll bring peace to that region, Lord. And we also continue to pray, Lord, for Ukraine and that peace would be restored to their country and that the enemies would turn back, Lord, and just thank you, Lord, for the stories of what you have been doing through this there, Lord, and drawing people to you, Lord, and just thank you, Lord, that in times like these, Lord, that we can really see how desperate our need is for you, and that doesn't change whether things are difficult or whether they're going smoothly, Lord. So it's just a time that we can recognize more clearly our need for you. Pray, Lord, for the Gadapi family, Lord, and for those that were close to Carolyn, that you'll comfort them during this time as they mourn her loss. But thank you, Lord, again, for the hope that we have in you of eternal life and just the confidence of knowing that she's with you and that she's in a good place. Pray, Lord, for Kyle Schmalling and for Ashley and just for wisdom for them, Lord, that you will make clear to them what your will is, and for Linden Bible Church as well, Lord, and just that you'll continue to guide that process, and just ask that your blessing will be on it with whatever final decision is made. And just pray, Lord, for the message today. And thank you, Lord, that we can come and gather together as a body of believers and look into your word and learn from it. And so just ask that you'll be with Pastor Joel and speak through him to us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Jan. I hear the kids rumbling. You may be released. No, let's get up and greet each other this morning. Just take a minute to do that. So say... Hey, Warren. Good to see you. I'm Joel.
Morgan, nice to meet you.
Hi, Rachel. Nice to meet you.
I'm a neighbor.
Oh, awesome. You got a good neighbor. Gather and they dismissed them. It's always good to hear the fellowship of believers, and we'll give you more opportunity to do that after the service. Just want to let, we're going to look into God's word this morning. Love to hear us as believers fellowshipping with each other. That's really important. We're going to look into God's word again this morning from 1 Peter. So if you have a Bible or a device, you can turn to 1 Peter. And we're going to start in verse 22 this morning. Let me just ask God to open my mouth and our hearts. So, Father, just open my mouth to speak whatever you would have me to speak from your word today. Thank you for your word and the blessing of it. And open our hearts to anything you have for us this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, there is often a tension, at least it seems like a tension in our world, a lot of misunderstanding, but that tension between truth and love. And it seems like we feel like we have to fall down on one side or the other of that. And I think that's particularly true for us as believers. But the neat thing about God's word is it teaches us that truth and love are inextricably welded together. I've entitled the sermon today, A Deep Love Based on an Eternal Word. I was reminded this week of the importance of us as a church, us as believers, having our faith, our beliefs and our practices, our behavior based on God's word. As you know, we chose to support our local Methodist church, who is withdrawing from the United Methodists over there. unwillingness to abide by the authority of God's word and therefore the moral imperatives in God's word. One of the stories that was told to me by one of those who was involved in that is that they were required to give to the denomination at some kind of meeting a statement on why they were disaffiliating, and in that statement they were asked to address the issue of human sexuality. So they gave their statement and based their beliefs on God's word, and then they had to be quiet while the uppity-ups had a chance to respond. And they were chastised for basing, getting their views on human sexuality from the Bible. And that pretty much sealed the deal of why they were leaving. And we commend them for that, and we need to keep them in our prayers. And it just shows us, I think, the utter importance of adhering to God's word and being obedient to God's word and using God's word as the authority for our lives. And it just was such a reminder to me of what Peter's going to talk about in 1 Peter this morning. So the context of 1 Peter 1:22 is that Peter is the apostle who is writing to the chosen sojourners, the elect exiles, as he calls us, you know, the resident aliens in this life who are believers in this case in Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. And he begins his treatise on the greatness of our salvation and all that God has done for us in calling us to himself. And then last week we looked at the fact that based on the greatness of our salvation, it should have a result in our life and his call to a holy living or a holy life. And he reminded us that we need to be prepared for holy living by being spiritually alert and focused and our minds set on the future, on what God is going to bring to us by his grace when Jesus comes. And then a call to resist being conformed to our old ways of life, who we were before we were saved, and instead live differently, a holy living based on God's character of holiness. And then he reminded us that we live in view of our Father's judgment one day on our life and our actions and our words, and a reminder that Jesus paid for our ransom. He paid to free us from the slave market of sin and Satan and death at great price with his precious blood. And that was according to God's eternal plan and makes our faith, as we sang this morning, it makes our faith secure and firm and our hope in Christ firm. Well, he's going to go on in verses 22, and I'm going to cover, Lord willing, verse 22 through chapter 2 and verse 3 with some other of the outgrowths of a holy, of this, who we are and a call to holiness. And he begins in verse 22 by saying, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. So he begins this section again by reminding us who we are. We're a purified people. We've had our souls, our lives purified by our obedience to the truth. In other words, by our acceptance of the truth of God's word and specifically the gospel. And by believing and trusting in that, we have been washed clean. We've been purified of our sins. We're saints whose lives have been made pure. And so he reminds them again who they are. And I was reminded of this, you know, a week or so ago when we had our futures banquet and we had a lady give her testimony named Jean Marie Davis, and she was a woman who unfortunately had undergone years and years and years of horrible abuse, being trafficked since very early in childhood, and then had come to know Christ. And as I listened to her testimony and as I listened to her story, I was reminded again, You know, that's who she, what she experienced in her life. But what I saw speaking to us that evening was a pure daughter of God. And you know, when I think about it, that's true for all of us. You know, we were brought out of the kingdom of darkness and out of sin into the purity of who God made us as sons and daughters of God through Christ. So that's who we are. And Peter goes on to show what it resulted in. He says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love. In other words, the result of God saving us, God purifying our lives, is that we have a sincere brotherly love for each other. This is just the natural result of a holy life. That what results when we come into the faith as believers is that we become part of a community of loving brothers and sisters. And he talks about that as if it's a natural result, that we now belong as believers to this community of loving brothers and sisters. You know, it's an interesting word that he uses here. He says, for a sincere brotherly love. That word brotherly love is the word Philadelphia. That's what that name means. Some call it the city of brotherly shove now instead of love. But, but you know, Philadelphia means brotherly love. And it's a kind of love that he says is a result of us coming into faith in Christ, that we become part of a community. Christianity isn't a lone ranger kind of thing. Christianity can't be lived independently and apart from all others, you know, holing up somewhere and trying to be holy. Christianity has to be lived in community, and that's why God created the church, the fellowship of believers. And he's reminding us here that, you know, the result of our salvation, of being a purified people who believe the truth, is that we become part of a community of loving brothers and sisters. This is something that's emphasized over and over in the New Testament. Hebrews 13:1 says, let brotherly love continue. Just a very direct command. Keep it up. This brotherly, sisterly love. And brothers includes brothers and sisters here. Romans 12 and verse 10, I think we have that verse, also reminds us that love one another with brotherly affection. And Fred's favorite verse, outdo one another in showing honor. You know, that there should be an affection. There should be a brotherly love for each other. And I love how Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, commends them for that and then also encourages that. In 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 9 and 10, he says, now concerning brotherly love. Now he's writing to this church in Thessalonica. You have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another. I mean, this is a high commendation. He says, you got the brotherly love thing down. You do a great job of loving each other. And when I think about us as a congregation, I often see how you guys are loving on each other as brothers and sisters in Christ and in a manifold number of ways. And that, you know, nothing makes us as leaders so glad as to see that, to see people reaching out to each other and loving each other and being there for each other and comforting each other. But he goes on to say, for this, that indeed is what you are doing to all the brothers throughout Macedonia. But we urge you, brothers, do this more and more. So he's saying, you know, next level. Let's go to the next level with this brotherly, sisterly love that ought to be a natural result of being in the body of Christ. Sorry for this, you know, I'm in football season now, but, you know, Ohio State beat Penn State the other day. They were two very evenly matched teams. I had my worries. Defenses dominated. They both played great. Both have young quarterbacks who made mistakes. The difference in the game was one individual. probably the best college football player, Marvin Harrison Jr., who they couldn't stop from catching the ball and making key plays. he was at another level. He's like probably going to be NFL first round, maybe first pick, I don't know. And it was very obvious they couldn't stop him. And I thought, what if we were like that as believers? What if we were next level brothers and sisters, loving brothers and sisters? I mean, he's saying, you know, you're doing this. That's good. Now take it to the next level. What would that mean for each of us as believers in terms of what we could do to encourage, to comfort, to strengthen, to serve our brothers and sisters in Christ? And he says not only, you see, what he's trying to teach us here is that part of a holy life is a love for the community of believers. And a growth in holiness leads to a deeper love among believers. So if we got an issue with loving our fellow brothers and sisters, we have an issue with holiness. And if we have an issue with holiness, we're not going to love our brothers and sisters well. See, this is love and truth working together. And he also says about this, to have a sincere brotherly love. That word sincere means literally not diluted. It was used in the ancient world of when they cut the good wine with water to make it go a little farther and sell it, make a little more money. And that was considered, that became the word for hypocrisy. It's not genuine. It's not the real deal. You know, it's a pretend replacement. And he's saying, when you love each other, you know, don't come to church with your mask on, your Sunday mask, you know, and pretend that you're someone you're not. You need to love sincerely, genuinely. It needs to be real in you. And if it's not real, then we need to ask ourselves why. We need to deal with our own hearts on why God, who loved us, we are not loving our brothers and sisters well. But he says, having purified your souls by your obedience to the truth for a sincere brotherly love, then he gives us what it obligates us to. He gives us the command, love one another earnestly from a pure heart. So who we are and what God has called us into as a community of loving brothers and sisters obligates us to something. It puts a responsibility on us. And that responsibility, again, is to love one another earnestly from a pure heart. This word love, it's interesting, two different words of love are used here. The brotherly love is that phileo, that Philadelphia love. This is the agapao love. This is the strong, deep kind of love, and it appears that Peter's using it with a little bit of a contrast. It's a deeper love. It's a stronger love. It's a more earnest love. Someone defined it this way: it's a way of life defined by righteous relationships with each other that are based on God's character. Love is based on a holy life, and a holy life is lived out by love. You know, as I was reading this week, I was reminded, somebody said it well. They said, you know, the word love has been so disabused by our culture. It's so wrongly defined by our culture. It's almost become meaningless. You know, what the world defines as love has nothing to do with how God defines what love is. And we need to understand that. We need to understand when, I don't remember the headline in the Caledonia the other day, some church saying, you know, well, we love, you know, we're called to love everyone, including, you know, those who are walking in extreme disobedience against God, you know, and his word. Well, we are in one sense. We're to love them by bringing the truth of the gospel to them, not by accepting unbiblical behavior and attitudes. And, you know, part of us as a church is, if we're going to truly be a loving church, it has to be based on upholding a moral standard, a holy lifestyle. And we're called to do that by Christ. But he says, when you love,
love one another earnestly. I love that word, eagerly, fervently, constantly. It has the idea literally of a love that's stretched out and strained, you know. In the football game, you know, when the player's right at the goal line, it strains to put that ball over the line, you know, giving every single effort in his body. You know, it's that kind of picture. You know, that word of love in such a way, when it's hard, when it's difficult, when there's all kinds of obstacles, when there's other things we could be doing, he says, be stretched out in your love. Be strained in your love for one another. When I used to run track centuries ago, you know, one of the things that they taught us is you always run not to the finish line, through the finish line. You know, you lean through that tape. You run to the other side of the finish line because, you know, you don't want to let up. And he's saying in that same kind of way, we need to have a love for each other that stretches and strains and puts out for particularly our brothers and sisters in Christ. It's interesting, this word earnestly is used in Luke 22:44 of Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane as he's facing the immensity of the cross and bearing all of our sins. It says he prayed earnestly. You know, he was stretched out. Drops of blood were coming. He was putting it all on the line to save us. And now we're called to love in that same kind of way. You know, the early church in Acts 12:5, it says that they were praying earnestly for Peter to be released from prison. And he's now writing this, you know. They were stretched out. They were on their knees. They were on their faces. Lord, you know, they've already killed James, you know, protect Peter, you know. And God answered those prayers. You know, it's used in the Old Testament, the Greek version of the Old Testament, in Joel and in Jonah, of real repentance, of a passion for the Lord. You know, when the king of Nineveh heard the message of Jonah, you know, he was very earnest. He's like, okay, everybody, stop the boat, you know. We're gonna repent. We're gonna get sackcloth and ashes. We're gonna beg God that maybe God, it said they prayed mightily, you know, they prayed earnestly that God would spare them, and he did. That's the kind of prayer that Peter's talking about here. And part of a holy life is earnest, strong, deep love for our brothers and sisters in Christ. And that love needs to come from a pure heart. You know, our hearts have been purified by the gospel. Now he says, put it to practice. Love each other from a pure heart as well. What does that look like for us as a body of believers? You know, how do we love each other in that kind of way? How do we go to next level love? I think it means we deal with offenses when they come up between us. You know, we do the hard stuff, you know. We work it out. We follow the biblical pattern. It means that we're going to have to deal with other parts of the body, you know, that have different personalities than us, that have different temperaments than us. That, you know, sometimes means we have to put aside our agendas and say, you know, the church is bigger than this. You know, I may like this kind of music, or I may like this or that kind of thing, or I wish we did this. And sometimes we just have to set that aside and say, how can I love the body of Christ in the best kind of way? Let's make that the priority. I think it also means making it a priority to fellowship. That's why I enjoyed listening to you guys this morning greet each other. You know, making it a point to, when we have a fellowship time, to be there. You know, to get to know each other, to sit around the table with people, to be in a life group or whatever, and to serve others, and to comfort those who are hurting, you know. You know, we got a memorial service coming up. What a great way to support a family. It doesn't matter if we know Carolyn or not. You know, what a great way to say, man, I love you guys. I know you're hurting. I know you need comfort. I want to be there. I'll bake some cookies. I'll send a card. I'll do whatever. I'll text, email, or maybe even make a phone call. Okay, I'm old school. sometimes hearing someone's voice goes a long ways. And why is this so vital that we love in this kind of way? Well, Peter's going to tell us.
He says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and abiding word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And this is the word, and this word is the good news that was preached to you. You know, one of the things he's going to remind us again, he's going to go back to give us reasons why this kind of love is so important, why a holy life is so important. It's because our new life is founded on the eternal word of God. He says, since you have been born again. Do we need another reminder of that? We're not who we used to be. We've been born again or anew. We're a new person in Christ. And therefore, we should act like new people in Christ in the way we love each other. You know, the old Joel, put your name in there. The pre-Jesus Joel, the bound to the flesh and the world and Satan Joel is no longer. We are new people, new Joels, or you put your name in there in Christ, born of the Holy Spirit, imbued with the life of Jesus, and bound for glory. And how did this change in us take place? Well, he tells us, you've been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable. You know, he's saying that our new life in Christ is not like our old life, you know, our physical life in Adam. It's an eternal life, not one that's just going to pass away. He's kind of comparing here our physical conception or procreation. You know, from the moment we were conceived by our parents, you know what? We're going to die. It comes with it. It's part of being physically a human being is that we're going to die one day apart from Christ. But our spiritual conception by the Holy Spirit through the word of God is eternal. It's imperishable. That's good news. You know, we have an imperishable life spiritually. And how did that come to us? Well, he tells us through the living and abiding word of God. I get excited about this. You know, sometimes, I shouldn't tell you this, but I will. Sometimes we like to ask this question as leaders. How do you know you're born again? How do you know you're saved? You know, we just like to go fishing a little bit. You know, what are you basing that on? And I think it's important because one of the reasons we ask that question is because we want to be sure that our salvation is based ultimately on God's word and the gospel. It's the only way that we can be born again. We must, first of all, trust that God's word is true. We must believe what it says about being born again, that it is on the basis of faith in the good news of the gospel about Jesus, namely that he died on the cross for my sin and he paid the price of God's judgment that our sin demanded, but also that I can be forgiven of my sin by admitting I'm a sinner and trusting in Christ by his death on the cross in my place and for my sin to save me. And he proved that by rising from the dead. You know, our salvation must be founded on the word of God, not by my best efforts, not by my emotional experiences, not even, and hear me rightly in this, by saying a sinner's prayer, you know, verbally, a verbal confession or an intellectual, yeah, I believe there's a God and I believe Jesus died on the cross. It's deeper than that. It's by being, and it's not by being baptized or attending the right church either. We have to have a heart transaction with the truth of God's word applied to our heart by the Holy Spirit of God. And this is why when we share Christ with others, when we involved in evangelism, and I hope we are, it is so important that we give them God's word. We may start with our experience and our testimony, and that's good. We may talk about what God has brought to our life, but ultimately we need to give others the word of God, the gospel, the good news of Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection to forgive us of our sins. Yes. So that brings up a question, and the question is, if we're going to base all of this on God's word and the work of the Holy Spirit working in tandem, is God's word trustworthy? See, this is a big issue for many today in the world, and sometimes even for believers. It's a crucial question. I was reading an article this week from World Magazine, and it's entitled Confronting Today's Lies, a Conversation with Rosaria Butterfield. And Rosaria Butterfield, she was a professor, she had a PhD from Ohio State. She's now an author, pastor's wife, and homeschool mom, and former professor of English and women's study at Syracuse University. In fact, she was a lesbian who wrote all of Syracuse University's statements on lesbianism. She came to know Christ, and you can read her story in The Secret Thoughts of an Unlikely Convert. She came to know Christ because a Christian pastor invited her to have lunch with her, and began to slowly just love her into Christ. And she calls it a complete, she said it made a complete train wreck of her life. And so she speaks about that, and she just wrote a current book, Five Lies of Our Anti-Christian Age. And I thought this fit in well with why God's word is so vital. And so the interviewer asked her, what are the five lies of our Christian age? And he named them from the book. And this is what they are. Homosexuality is normal. Number two, being a spiritual person is kinder than being a biblical Christian. Number three, feminism is good for the world and the church. Transgenderism is normal. And modesty is an outdated burden that serves male dominance and holds women back. And she talks about the underlying seeds of what drives all of that philosophy. People are saying today, God's word relevant today, 21st century? You got to be kidding me, we're reminded by Peter that two things characterize God's word. He says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable. And how did that happen? Through the living and abiding word of God. So Peter says there's two things that characterize God's word. Number one, it's living. And number two, it's abiding or enduring. And I want to camp there for a little bit. It's living. Again, sorry for being a football watcher. If you watch any football lately, you've seen a commercial that's on way too much from State Farm featuring Patrick Mahomes' boo and Jake, the State Farm guy. And they're in the locker room, and, Mahomes is like the coach, and they're all rah-rah, the guys, kind of brotherly love there. And he says, there's one important word to define our season, I'm going to get it wrong. And he says, I can't remember. I remember the one word. Oh, bundle, home, and auto is the answer. So there's one important word, right? And Jake says, bundle, home, and auto. And one guy says, well, that's four words. And he said, and Jake says, not if you bundle them. But what I love about the commercial is this, the reaction of the guy who hears that answer is it's like he gets electrified with electricity. It's and people start pouring Gatorade over their head and ripping off their shirts, because the four words were really one word, bundle. But what that showed me is what it means to be alive. God's word is living, We need to have a little of that in our understanding of God's word, that it's living, it's electric, it is not dead. It is not just an ancient document written by fallible men, probably patriarchal men of an ancient past, a different era that has no importance or significance or relevance to 21st century people. That's a lie that the world is promoting it. Your kids are hearing it in public school. God's word is alive, brothers and sisters. It is God's very word. God's word spoken to humankind of all ages, and every word and all the words of Scripture are God's objective truth to us. And it has spiritual power. It has spiritual power to transform our lives, our thinking, who we are, and our eternal destiny. God's word is always relevant to every generation because it is ultimate truth. And truth doesn't change. There isn't, as we are being told today, your truth and my truth, small t. There's only one truth, capital T, and that's God's truth. And God's truth is found in God's word. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Truth doesn't change. And I will also say, neither does human nature. God's word has changed the world. Billions of people have come to know Christ through God's word. And here's the good news. God's word can change your life and my life today. Do we believe that? Do we act like we believe it by placing the highest priority on inculcating God's word into our lives and minds and the hearts and minds of our children as well? Sharing it freely with others who desperately need it. You know, you have, I was going to have you hold up your Bible, but you'd all hold up your phones, but but hold them anyway. You have in your hands the greatest treasure the world has ever known. It ought to be electric for us. It is God's word. It is that you will never have anything in this life greater than the word of God. You need to know that. We need to know that. We need to act like that's true. We need to rejoice in it. We need to read it. We need to let it change us. And I'll tell you, if I could do one thing as a pastor, it would be this. It would be to convince you, to inspire you, to motivate you to read and obey God's word, because it will change your life and it will turn this church and this community upside down for Christ. It is powerful. It is living. Praise God. It's His word. It is also abiding. It is enduring. It is eternal. You know, Peter says it's not something that'll pass away and become obsolete and be lost to history. Though many have predicted this and they've been proven wrong and they're now long gone and dead. In fact, there are only a few things that are eternal in this world. And to name a few, there is God, His word, some angelic beings, and our eternal souls. Those are the things that are eternal. God's word may fall out of fashion or favor with the world or the elites or the celebrities or the intelligentsia, but the Apostle Paul reminds us that it will remain forever. You know, what he's trying to tell us here is that we're to love one another because we've been born anew into a fellowship of God's people that will last eternally. That's why he's stating this whole thing. You know, you've been changed. You've been born anew by the living and abiding word of God, and that has put you into a community of believers that's eternal. And so, yeah, keep loving each other because you're going to be doing that for all eternity. So that person who bugs you in the church, you know, they're here for eternity. Let's learn to love them well now, okay? Let's keep working on it. And someday all of our stuff is going to be gone and it's going to be wonderful. And he gives the reason. He quotes from Isaiah 40, verses 6 through 8, "For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord remains forever." I love that verse. I memorized it as a child from Isaiah 40. And interesting, the context of Isaiah 40, you know, Isaiah basically can be divided into two sections.
Chapters 1 through 39 is judgment on Israel because of their sin. Chapters 40 through 66 is comfort because God's going to restore them. This is in chapter 40, right at the break. And he's telling them, you know, look up. One day I'm sending the Messiah and the Savior, and he's going to come. And then he's going to fulfill everything that I have said in my word. Because, you know, the human beings, human life, the people of this world, humankind, they're like grass. And they're going to wither and die. You know, we're born into this world, and, you know, we're just living in the little dash between the date of birth and the date of death, you know, physically as human beings. But he said something else is eternal that's going to last forever, and that's God's word. He says, and not only is our flesh like grass, but all its glory like the flower of grass. So popes, presidents, potentates, and all people have physical life, bodily existence that's short-lived and temporary. People come and go, including those that hate God, persecute believers, or cause us trouble. Like the grass in our yards and fields, it will soon wither and die. But not only that, like the clover or the Indian paintbrush that graces our fields or the dandelions in our yards, the flowers of the grass soon fall off and die. You know, sorry about always talking about bees, but when Steve's brother told me when I became a beekeeper, you're going to start noticing when everything flowers and all of the plants in the fields, and he was so right. I think of it all the time. Now I drive home and I look out at my lawn in the spring, and I was like, dandelions. I used to hate dandelions, tried to get rid of them. Now I love them because they're the first nectar source for the bees, you know? And then at the end of the season, you know, I drive down, I see my neighbor's fields all filled with ragweed. What do you call that? And all you guys are sneezing and crying and all of that, and I'm saying, yeah, because that's the last nectar source of the season, you know? But you know what happens this time of year? It's all dead and gone, and I got to feed my bees sugar water, you know? You know, so I'm very aware of that. I'm aware of the temporary nature of all of those things. It's made me more aware of that. Life on this earth is temporary. It's short-lived. All of our accomplishments, all of the stuff that we work so hard for, you know, the money, the material things, you know, being beautiful and strong for a few of you, the positions of power and prestige will all one day be a distant memory. All of our accomplishments will be nothing more than certificates for the trash bin. You know, I think of this when I open my dresser drawer. In the top drawer, I have a bunch of junk, you know, things you save because, you know, and I got medals there from when I won the state championship as a runner, and it's like green now. And in the bottom drawer is like all the places I graduated from, and so what? You know, it just takes up room in my dresser now. All of that, just who cares? It's all just going to pass away. It's not going to amount to things we were so proud of, you know. It's all just going to pass away. But brothers and sisters, one thing will not pass away. And that is God's word. Yeah. But the word of the Lord remains forever. It's abiding and enduring for all eternity. And when this world is wrapped up at the end of this age, burned up and remade anew, God's word will still be relevant, still be read, still be studied, still be rejoiced in, and still be praised. That's what we're going to be doing in heaven. We're still going to have God's word in heaven. Isn't it going to be fun? Daniel, I read this about you. Can you explain this? Oh, that'll be fun. So I'm going to ask us again, do we believe that God's word is alive? That it can transform every heart, including ours? That it is life-giving for daily living? That it can be trusted despite its critics? That it has the real answers to the issues, the problems, the values, and vices of our day. If we believe that, then
and we should put a priority on knowing and living out what it says. It's worth real study. It's worth real meditation, not just the curse.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say word. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. I will build my life upon.